Okay, so I think it has turned to being the time to start. So let's go ahead and start this. Welcome. It's always a pleasure to give a talk in to the science circle in Second Life. Today I'll be talking about silicon chemistry and its consequences for silicon-based life. If you wanted to follow along with the talk, I've actually made some links outside of Second Life that you can get to. If you click on either of the objects to the left or right of the screen, the octahedron on the left or the tetrahedron on the right, it'll bring up a note card, and you can cut and paste the link into a browser and actually get to these slides and a little website where I put some animated GIFs and the like. So here we go. Silicon chemistry and its consequences for silicon-based life. Let's see. Now, as I was putting this talk together, I became overwhelmed and figured, oh my God, I've got way too much to talk about in an hour. So this is going to be part one, silicon at high temperatures, silicate-based chemistry. In a future talk, I'll talk about perhaps some cryogenic silicon-based chemistry that might be relevant. So for today, there's always going to be gratuitous cat photos. That's Seth. He's one of my minions. The other one is in the background. I'm going to talk about science fiction a little bit today, just kind of keeping in mind that we have never found any silicon-based life, and it's going to be hard for us to find silicon-based life given the given what we have available in terms of our ability to explore the universe at the current time. We should probably address what is life anyway, and does silicon have any role in terrestrial life? And there's always a question, can we just take terrestrial life and search and replace for carbon for silicon, or rather, silicon for carbon? And spoilers, no. But does that have to mean that silicon-based life can't happen? So, more at the end of the talk, I'll talk about my ideas about what silicon-based life could be based on if I were giving advice to a science fiction writer. And of course, there's always the usual thank yous and the like at the end. So in science fiction, this is probably the most famous sort of science. Reference to silicon-based life. There was an episode of the original Star Trek called The Devil in the Dark, and there was a creature which kind of looked like an upset pizza, I guess. It was called a Horta. They even sell action figures. They even sell Horta action figures these days. There's an image. I saw one in the store not too long ago. This particular series has a lot of silicon-based life form in the reboot in the 1988 series, The Next Generation. There was an episode called Memory Alpha where they had nanites. And nanites were molecular machines, basically, that a very timely reference that could replicate and interact with each other. And you'll note that just a few weeks ago, the 2016 Nobel Prize was for chemistry was given for development of molecular machines. The ones we have right now are very far away from being life forms. My favorite reference, of course, is silicon chip life forms from another Star Trek, where the quote, "ugly bags of mostly water," which is their name for us, comes from. There are other series. I'm suspicious of Dune. Those sandworms are suspiciously sensitive to moisture. You put them in water, they boil and thrash about and do all sorts of weird chemistry things. And, in their larval stage, they This is fiction. They seek out and encapsulate water to protect their desert from this, well, anthropogenic pollutant in the story. You know, and then there's others that you can point to, Neuromancer and other cyberpunk fiction basically have as one of their tropes artificial intelligences, and they would be potentially alive, but they would be computer programs in silicon chips. And E.E. Smith's frigid-blooded poison breeders, where the chemistry is not specified beyond those four words, so you can basically say whatever you want about them, etc. There's been a lot of discussion of silicon-based life in science fiction. So we come back to Earth. What do we know about silicon-based life on in the scientific literature? Well, SciFinder is the American Chemical Society's database. So this is a search through the chemical literature for the words silicon-based life. I found 11 references. Okay, and there's like billions of references in SciFinder. So two recent ones, one that goes back a little further, and then even further back. There were about 251 references which contained all three of those words, but they are more about the performance of electronic devices. I particularly like these two. If you look at the titles, one is silicon-based life in the solar system, and then a few months later in the same journal, there is no silicon-based life in the solar system. This pretty much sums up the debate on silicon-based life. These two papers were looking at whether the methane lakes on Titan would be suitable places to find silicon-based life. And, well, a theme throughout this talk is that carbon is so much better at doing life than silicon is. David Jacobs' response being that if there is life on Titan, it's probably carbon-based, is appropriate. So in a future talk, probably part two of my silicon-based life forms, if I don't get ridiculed too much for this one, will be about cryo-based silicon life, its possibilities. I coined the term Neptuna fish for such life. It's mine, I'll copyright it. Yay. So what is life, and where can I get one? Here's some examples of terrestrial life. I've got two of them with me right now. Hopefully that lump, who's right next to the keyboard and purring away, is not interfering in the quality of your sound. He's sitting behind me. And sadly, Sin, who was with me for my last talk, he passed away this summer. He had liver cancer. So back to the slide, what is life? NASA's definition of life is that it's a self-sustaining chemical system capable of Darwinian evolution. So I'm going to focus on chemical systems. I'm not going to focus on silicon chips and things like that. I was actually trying to find the report where this phrase was. I couldn't actually find it, but it is discussed there. You'll notice I put a lot of references on my slides. I do like to use these slides back in my own lectures when I teach appropriate material. So let's see, germanium. Yeah, you know, germanium is an interesting element as well. It does a lot of the same things silicon does. There may be some flexibility there. So going back 50 years, there's an idea back then, about a year before I was born, that clay and silicates were involved in the origin of life. And here's some references for those. If you are looking at the PDF version of my talk, these links would be live and you could get to them. You know, the idea back then was that clays are made up of layers, and the layers could break apart, and one layer that was broken apart could encourage the formation of a new one, kind of like what we think of when DNA is split apart and the individual strands encourage or guide the formation of new strands. So the idea that regular carbon organics could layer on clay to kind of get a template going for interesting chemistry to happen has been proposed. Here's a table of contents reference from Industrial Engineering Chemistry Research. This is an American Chemical Society journal, and I just kind of wanted to show what those pictures kind of look like. Here's a clay. Basically, it's an artificial clay called a zeolite. In modern research, what people do is put either metal complexes or small, almost single atoms of noble metals like platinum, ruthenium, rhodium, things like also vanadium oxides and things, and watch them as those supported metal catalysts transform organics from one from the starting materials to products. In this particular one, they're removing ethanol by just turning it into carbon dioxide. Okay, so why silicon? You know, it seems there's a lot of elements in the periodic table. Why do we pick on silicon for not forming life? Right? It's kind of like, well, your big brother carbon is forming life. What are you doing with your life? And silicon just basically says, well, I make rocks. And, you know, there are reasons why we pick on silicons. Silicon and carbon both have four electrons in their outermost shell. They can both form four bonds at once. They're in the same family. Hence my little joke earlier. Germanium's down here. There's not a lot of talk about germanium-based life, but the chemistry of silicon and germanium are very, very similar. But the abundance of silicon is much, much more than that of germanium, so that's probably why we think of silicon-based life. Oops. So, abundances, that is an important thing. Now here's an interesting statistic. I didn't quite realize in the, before this week actually, in the Earth's crust, carbon is basically about 0.03% abundant, while silicon is 28% abundant. So that's a sharp contrast, because there's so much more silicon on Earth that if it were useful in any way, it should be are useful to our life in any way, we should be full of it. Okay, so essentially the abundance is in sharp contrast to its presence in living thing, but I do want to point out that's not due to any inability of our biochemistry, like what makes us tick, to handle silicon. Okay, for some comparison, iron is 5%, manganese is 1%, and vanadium, which you don't think of as being particularly common, is down at 0.01%, about one-third as abundant as carbon, which seems to be everywhere. Let's see. So, plants handle silicon very well. Diatoms have pretty much mastered using silicon. Diatoms are I think they're marine algae, in fact, that dissolve silicon out of water and build skeletons, essentially made out of glass, to support themselves. And, you know, from what I was looking at this week, rice, barley, many other plants actually have ways of handling silicon. In fact, silicon in, I think it was the rice, was able to help increase the movement of iron, especially under conditions where the iron wasn't particularly available. Next slide. So, diatoms, as I said, they build skeletons, beautiful little affairs. I've got some slides on them. And they manage the deposition of the silicon dioxide. So it's not just like a little chunk of broken glass. It's a real nanostructure. I usually like to show structures of some of these key proteins. I found one, but it hadn't been released yet. It wasn't made publicly available yet on the Royal Society's protein database. So no pics, sorry. But basically these proteins tend to be comprised of 10, that seems like a lot to me, transmembrane alpha helices, which all you really need to know is like probably looks like 10 intertwined corkscrews that go through a cell membrane. And diatoms, I think these are the skeletons of diatoms, and each little species of diatom is going to give you a different morphology to its skeletons. These are electron micrographs. I think we can agree that diatoms have pretty much mastered how to make a silicon or a silicate structure. The details in these just indicate how well the organism can manage the deposition of the silicate. When the diatoms die, they these skeletons tend to deposit on the bottom of the bottom of the ocean or wherever they happen to be, and can later be mined. There's a product called diatomaceous earth, which is basically the glass skeletons of all of these guys. I use this stuff in my own lab as an aid to filtration. And yeah, I see a pillow, I see a disc, sneakers, and an oil barrow. I like that. Okay. Excuse the weird pauses. Changing slides is means I have to think. Now, it's relatively easy to breed the ability to handle silicon into terrestrial life. Here's an example. The Arnold Group at Caltech found some thermophiles living under highly basic and hot conditions. And basically, after three generations living in a lab environment which was spiked with silanes, a form of silicon, they were able to increase the ability of one of the main enzymes, cytochrome C, to put silicon into the hydrocarbons these things made by a factor of 2,000. So, three enzymes. Or I'm sorry, three generations of selective breeding allowed the enzyme to evolve into a better silicon handling enzymes. And three generations isn't very much. If that amount of work can increase the effectiveness so much, the conclusion is that our kind of life is doing very well without using silicon. Thank you very much. Okay. Just to highlight some other artificial uses. We use it, well, not me personally, but it is used in research. On the left, you see an artificial amino acid. Amino acids, of course, are the building blocks of protein. And to be an amino acid, you have a amine group attached to a carbon, attached to an acid group, that those three pieces make it an amino acid. Often you've got something else attached. And the variability actually comes in this last group. Usually it's something like a phenyl group or a hydrogen. If you're talking cysteine, it's an SH group. This is a trimethyl silyl methyl. So it's basically a silicon with four carbons attached to it, and it's attached to this guy. Why would you try to incorporate that into normal biological systems? Well, the SIME3 group could be detected, and where it ends up in a protein could be tracked, because the silicon can be tracked by things like silicon NMR spectroscopy. Other people use small molecules with silicon in. Here's two silicons in this small molecule to test biochemical receptor sites. All right, next slide, I show you one of those biochemical receptor sites. Okay, so my infamous cross-eyed view, this is a stereogram. In the upper right, there is the whole protein. The protein is a dimer, and it actually has, hard to see with this red pointer, it actually has a receptor molecule, or that small molecule I just showed you, inside its active site. And on the mid-left, each of these structures is the same structure, just from a slightly different point of view. And you can see the molecule sitting in the active site. And if you look at it just right and cross your eyes, you can see a 3D view. Again, this is my favorite display of molecules using JMOL to do the magic eye version. So the question is, can we search and replace silicon for carbon? No. Okay, and if this were the Mirror Mirror Star Trek universe, I would be evil and just end the talk there. And while I may be evil, I won't end the talk there. So, there are reasons. Wait, what? Why? Well, silicon and carbon don't do the same thing. They've got different bond strengths. Silicon hates to do multiple bonding. Carbon loves to do double bonds and triple bonds and things like that. Silicon is not so fond. And before I get into too much trouble, yes, I do realize that carbon and silicon are atoms and don't have the neurons with which they would, you know, have emotions with. But I do like anthropomorphization. Electronegativity, carbon and silicon just have different abilities to attract electrons to themselves in bonds. Carbon and hydrogen are about the same electronegativity, so they share electrons fairly evenly. Silicon is a little less electronegative than hydrogen, which gives a silicon-hydrogen bond a polarization. It's more like H minus when a hydrogen is attached to silicon. And that's very different from how hydrogen behaves in life. There's also size, silicon is bigger, and there's also redox, which is short for the ability to undergo electron transfer reactions. Okay, so I'm going to focus on just a couple of these for a second. I'll try not to go into too many creepy details. Here's a table, sorry. But here's a table, and to take the sting off of it, I drew a picture of a cat. So, bond energies we have to worry about. Here's a comparison of silicon and hydrogen. I just mentioned that. I'm sorry, carbon-hydrogen bonds and silicon-hydrogen bonds. The units, kilojoules per mole. Let's just think of them as relative numbers. Carbon forms stronger bonds with hydrogen than silicon does. And that's going to mean that the silicon-hydrogen is going to be more reactive than the carbon-hydrogen usually. My take-home messages are up in the upper right-hand side of these slides. Looking at carbon-carbon bonds, I've got them listed twice, carbon-carbon bonds and silicon carbon bonds and silicon-silicon bonds. When the bond involves silicon, it's weaker. Again, that's just going to be making it more reactive. The other thing, carbon forms long chains. So things like garbage bags made of polyethylene have like tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of carbons all attached to each other in a chain. Silicon that peters out after maybe, I don't know, five, six, eight repetitions. Silicon does not form the long chains of silicon-silicon bonds that carbon does. Okay? Who would thought that numbers could tell you things? This one is really quite striking. So if we look at a carbon-carbon double bond, it's worth 602. A silicon-silicon double bond is worth about 100. I wouldn't worry about the 0.32 there. It's from a calculation, so it's going to be an estimate anyway. A carbon-silicon double bond, in fact, is 163. So silicon is really not in it for the double bonding. And all of those fancy multiply bonded rings that make your DNA hold together, which involve carbon, just can't exist for silicon. If you were to use a replicator on Star Trek and just build DNA and search and replace all the carbon atoms for silicon atoms, what would happen is that it would react with the water and turn into silicate, probably boil and give off some unpleasant odor. At least that's what usually happens in my lab when I do something interesting. And finally, carbon oxygen and silicon oxygen bonds have some important differences. It's the comparison between the two that's important. If silicon can form single bonds, it's going to do so because it can release more energy out of single bonds and get to a lower resting state, a lower potential energy state that way than by using silicon like oxygen double bonds. These two numbers are basically used to explain why carbon dioxide is a gas and silicon dioxide is going to be a network solid like quartz. Alrighty, yes, silicates are very important. So why this multiple bonding thing? There's reasons. These pictures I built up in Second Life. A carbon-carbon bond, if you think of the p orbitals on carbon, orbitals are where electrons can go, and they have phase. They're basically from wave functions. So they have phase. They can have a positive amplitude, they can have negative amplitude. The amplitude doesn't have any real physical meaning, but guides who can overlap and bond to what. So in this particular picture, red areas of the same color, can overlap and form bonds. Now in carbon, there's no internal structure to these places where the electrons can go. In silicon, since silicon is a heavier element, there is internal structure. And there is, in fact, a reversal. You go from a small green lobe close to the nucleus to a red lobe further away. There's a reversal in sign. And the consequence of that is that when you bring those atoms close together, you're going to get a mismatch up close to the nucleus, and that's going to give you a repulsive force. That's not felt for carbon. So essentially the silicon-silicon won't do multiple bondings because when you get close enough to actually form effective double bonds or triple bonds with silicon, there's more repulsions happening. You can also think of it as, well, silicon has a lot more electrons and they're close to the nucleus, and those electrons are going to be more repulsive if the silicons get too close. So, yes. Nevertheless, there are things called silenes. Here's an example. It's got the silicon-silicon double bond in it. And there's a lot of organic shrubbery protecting the silicon-silicon double bonds. I chose this one because it happens to have a ferrocenyl unit in it, which has got an iron atom in. Basically, to keep silenes stable, you have to protect them from the environment. So this one again is a cross-eyed stereographic view. I kind of have to be careful because I like to look at them too, and then I get distracted. Basically, you can see that the silicons are very well protected from the environment. So, will this sort of thing help with life? Well, no. If your active site has to be protected from the environment and can't interact with the environment and do any chemistry with the environment, then that kind of limits what you can do with, in a living organism. The other thing I'd like to point out is that while we like to call ourselves carbon-based life forms, and there is a lot of carbon in us, we have a large supporting cast, that all of which do very important things. Hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen are very important, of course. Phosphorus, zinc, sulfur, and iron, basically do a lot of good things for us. Our cells are full of all sorts of different salts: sodium, potassium, magnesium, calcium, chloride tends to be the counterion. There are all sorts of trace elements. Some of which we're supposed to have in us, some of which we're not, like lead. There's a huge supporting cast from the periodic table that helps carbon do its thing. One question that comes up right now is why phosphorus instead of silicon? Silicon is a lot more abundant. And in DNA, let's see, where's the phosphorus? Phosphorus is this yellow thing. And basically, in DNA, it is phosphate that is forming the, not the rungs of the ladder, but the supporting sides of the ladder that holds the DNA together. Basically, it's an inorganic polymer with organic groups that bridge across the rungs. Why couldn't silicon do it? Well, the question there comes one of bioavailability. And I'm going to inflict upon you some Purbaix diagrams. They're cool things. So what do they tell us? They kind of tell us what form an element or a compound will take depending on conditions, like pHs or redox conditions. And when I say redox condition, I simply mean the availability of electrons, and something that we would quantify using volts. Let's see. So it turns out that silicon is going to be more available under reducing conditions, where electrons are going to be more available, let's say, and basic conditions, where H plus is less available, maybe OH minus is more available. So a Purbaix diagram tells us about the map. It maps out where certain conditions are stable. And there's a couple of flavors of them. I'm going to show you the ones that have more potential versus pH. Oops. Okay, so here's one for iron. And I've added the little green line because that's kind of an estimate of where normal living conditions happen to be. So, in or around the circle are in or around the green circle is where you would expect to find the conditions where living organisms that we know about can survive. And the circle itself would be where the most extreme conditions. So, high pH is very basic conditions over on this side, low pH is. 4 is about the acidity of vinegar, by the way. 10 is about the acidity of commercial ammonia cleaner. So x-axis is more about availability of H pluses. Y-axis, so is potential, and that's more about how to change the availability of electrons. So up here at the top of the diagram, we have for this diagram, we have iron 3. In the middle, we have iron 2. At the bottom, we have iron solid. All of those are just related by number of electrons, right? It would take 3 electrons plus an iron 3 plus to make an iron neutral. It would take 2 electrons to make an iron neutral. The blue lines are significant because water has its own reactivity, and water can be oxidized to make O2. That's one of the blue lines. The bottom line is water being reduced to make H2. And basically, the blue lines tell you where water is thermodynamically stable. You notice my green, I haven't really stuck within the blue lines. That's because thermodynamics isn't the whole story when you're talking about biological systems. You have to worry about kinetics as well, how fast reactions happen. So there are some extremophiles that can live outside of the conditions where normally, by thermodynamics, you'd expect water to be unstable. So here's a Courbet diagram for silicates, and I've added the green circle. It's a different units on X and Y. Well, not different units, different scaling on X and Y. That's why the green circle isn't the same shape, but it's a generous estimate of where the normal living conditions are. And silicon with voltage on y-axis and acidity on x-axis, silicon has a variety of forms that you would expect it to take. I think this green line is one of the states where water would react. So is the blue line. Vertical lines, like this line called number 3, relate H3SiO4 minus to H2SiO4 2 minus. These two forms are simply related by loss of a proton. I've got a next slide that helps. One thing I wanted to point out is that in the region where you would expect to find living things, silicon is going to be octahedral. Here's an H7SiO6. So silicon is going to have six things attached to it. So it's going to look more like the aluminate structure I've got just at the edge of the screen here. Let's see if I can move it. Oops, I got that in the wrong place. So this guy. Oh, I've just moved its base. All right. That's fairly evil of me. There we go. Oh, and now I'm just moving parts of it. So I'm going to stop doing that because that's evil. But essentially, that would be the shape of silicon under living conditions. Well, living conditions don't like octahedra that much. Our living conditions pretty much like tetrahedra. That's why hexavalent chromium is so bad. Something like Cr O4 2 minus looks just like phosphate to our cells. So a hexavalent chromium can, because it's the right shape, can be incorporated into our cells. And once it's inside, it's like, ha ha, I'm not phosphorus after all. I am chromium. Give me your electrons. Chromium 3 plus instead of chromium 6 plus, right? Hexavalent chromium is chromium 6 plus. Chromium 3 plus is octahedral. So The cells aren't fooled by chromium 3 plus. It can't get into the cells. That's the same as the silicon octahedra here. So, our kind of life doesn't really like to deal with octahedral molecules that much. I don't think there's a reason why it can't. It would particularly just need to be bred to be able to. So, since I'm talking about silicon life forms, where's the horta going to live? Well, kind of underground when you're talking about high temperatures, high pressures, and lots of minerals around, you tend to think of more basic and more reducing conditions. Okay, if you put together a whole bunch of Purbaix diagrams, you'd probably think of ye olde horta living over here. So silicates are going to be important for a silicon organism that would be living under those conditions. It wouldn't have silicon-silicon bonds. It would probably have a lot of silicon oxygen. And, you know, we kind of have to think about what water is going to do, the green lines. And remember also this particular diagram is for 25 degrees Celsius, one atmosphere pressure. We have to worry about water above its supercritical point, basically high pressure, high temperature, where you wouldn't be able to tell the difference between the gas phase and the liquid phase. That's going to be a much more aggressive medium. Okay, so the horta here's a who. Starting my little section on the advice for someone writing some hard science fiction. We're going to expect an environment to be reducing, basic, hot, high pressure, high temperature. Things you have to worry about. Iron and carbon can reduce silicates to silicon, but having an aqueous environment would set limits on that behavior. So I kind of think that the horta would have to have some water around to make its chemistry work, unless it was just purely a silicon thing. Underground, we're going to get fairly aggressive conditions, supercritical water, if there's actually deposits or pools of water that are available for chemistry. I kind of think that magma itself, or like liquid rock, is going to be way too aggressive for interesting, I'll use the word interesting to basically say self-catalytic, for interesting chemistry to develop. You know, because there's just so much energy there that large structures are going to be just too much, too fragile. Okay, and we can kind of look at what's happening in research labs now for hydrothermal synthesis of interesting structures like zeolites, which do catalysis, to give us a clue as to what sort of conditions we might look for silicon life under. Again, if we were writing the science fiction. So, minerals are a wonderful source of insight, silicon, you know, and silicates. You know, so assumed basis of silicon-based life is going to have to cope with the tendencies of silicates to form minerals. Here's the thing. We're going to have to assume that there's a very limited supply of carbon. Otherwise, we're going to get carbon-based life, maybe with silicon incorporated, maybe with silicon doing what phosphorus does for our kind of life. But you know, I've built this talk thinking that how are we going to make silicon be the main player in here? For Darwinian processes. Remember that while crystals grow, minerals aren't alive. They don't have Darwinian processes that improve them and make them more reproductively successful. For Darwinian processes, we have to encode information. So I've asked the question, how can information be encoded by silicates? Well, there are structural features of silicates, and I'm going to introduce aluminate so that we can talk about aluminosilicates. The different structural features tend to be based on tetrahedra, and that's what's shown on the left of this slide, and octahedra, which is shown on the right, and I've got models beside the screen. And essentially what happens is that these units, these aluminosilicates, can share vertices. And they don't have to be limited to silicon and aluminum. You can have other metals like iron, manganese, I like vanadium. I wrote an article on vanadium once, to substitute into the octahedra. Another educator in Second Life, I used Dr. K's molecular resin kit to build the tetrahedral model and the octahedral model, and I superimposed the little glowy pyramids on top. All right. So one nice thing is that we can represent the structures of minerals with just these shapes, the silicates and the tetrahedra and aluminates and other metals as octahedra. I'm actually sitting on my model that I built to put together tetrahedra. A tetrahedron can be thought of as being based on a pared down cube. Basically what I found when I was building some of these models was that it was just easier to put together cubes, rotate them so that the vertices I wanted to touch would touch, and then remove the cubes later. And I love the silicate. I'm actually surprised because I've got a cat just behind my screen absorbing all the heat from the exhaust of the computer, purring away, and it doesn't seem to be howling at me while I'm talking. It's a nice change. So in solution, we know about what silicates can do. In solution, they can form short chains and rings. So in fact, this is an Si6O18-12-. And I built one of these, and here's just a quick picture of it before I had taken the cubes away. Basically, it's just six cubes with corners touching, and the tetrahedra within, made sure that they touched the at vertices. This sort of motif is seen in a lot of minerals. It wasn't easy to make a tetrahedron. Actually, the easiest place to make a tetrahedron was in Second Life, but measuring and getting things to look kind of scientifically accurate was a bit of a trick. Okay, so over the last few months since I started thinking about this, I've asked the question, well, how likely is a silicate-based DNA? And here's the first thing I'm going to talk about. This is one of the models that's floating above you. Maybe I can move it down to floor level. And Hopefully I'm not going to just crush people with, well, I won't move way too far down, because that would crush people with rocks, which is an unfriendly thing to do during a talk. So, this doesn't really represent anything known, but there's a red chain of tetrahedra, and there's a blue chain of tetrahedra. And kind of if you place yourself at one of the ends of the chains, the blue one, if you're at the end of the chain, spirals away in a, I want to say that's a left-handed spiral. And if you're at the end of the chain of the blue, of the red one, it spirals away in a right-handed spiral. So silicates can have a property called chirality. At least the model that I've shown here could have a property of chirality, which is a handedness. And I happen to have fused one of those SI6 rings onto each of the chains, and I have them holding some sort of, I don't know, maybe it's a metal, a ball, some sort of ball in between them. And I thought, this is the kind of thing our DNA does. But there's some problems with this. Let's say that we had all left-handed spirals. For this particular structure, to hold a ball in between the two little rings, the chains would have to be at 90 degrees. And that doesn't make for a nice strand. While chirality is something that our kind of life, it's like the textbook, if it was alive, it's chiral. I mean, it's basically a key point about our kind of life. I don't know if that is true for all sorts of life, but I kind of think that this thing that I've drawn is just not going to cut it. Why? Well, these silicates tend to like to share vertices. If you put too many of these red and blue things I've drawn together, they're just going to form layers in some sort of larger silicate structure. Okay, so this thing, yeah, this kind of thing is out. While it's nice to draw, and I found the experience to be very instructive, and it's particularly pretty, I'd be surprised if strands of silicates could do the job for us if we were trying to encode information. Okay, so yeah. And the thing is, in solution, you can build these chains. They wouldn't stay as left-handed or right-handed. They're like necklaces. They would just flop around. I'm going to have to escape out of editing stuff. There we go. Basically, these chains probably aren't going to be enough to encode information. There we go. Well, how could we encode information? Well, let's look at some mineral structures. Let's actually look at some data. This first one, let me edit that and bring it down. Oops, discard. I have note cards in all of these things. Okay, so this is jadeite, and it happens to be a sodium aluminum silicate. Its structures, or its formulas, NaAlSi2O6, but it won't form molecules. It forms sheets. The big purple things are the sodiums. The tan tetrahedra are The silicate units and the kind of brownish atoms are alumina. And this would be one layer of jadeite. Why jadeite? Well, there are all sorts of minerals out there, and if you go into the various databases, you can get crystal structures of many, many, many minerals. One thing I wanted to point out is that the octahedra and tetrahedra tend to be negatively charged, and so small cations or smaller units that have positive charge, like the sodium cation, can live in the spaces in between the octahedra and tetrahedra. And these spaces could be used for encoding information. Maybe a sodium and a potassium get swapped out. That's certainly possible. This jadeite, though, tends to form 3D structures, less sheets than just something that's going to be very difficult to pry apart. Let's see, so let's move jadeite out. I'll edit up. Up. The recording is going to be awfully interesting with all of this stuff happening. Okay. So that guy forms more of a 3D structure. How are we on time? I'm going a bit long. Here's another structure I found. I've actually got a rotating 3D GIF on our website. My partner was kind enough to give me some space on his corporate website. Yay! And I've got 3D stereogram GIFs of this thing floating around. And the beautiful thing is that you can see absolutely clear layers of aluminosilicate separated by smaller cations. This particular one has a H2F cation in it, so that kind of tells me it was formed under conditions where it had a little bit of acidity going on. This particular structure is a neutron diffraction structure from 1971, and you know, most of the time we're looking, I show you X-ray crystal structures because they're easy to do. Neutron diffraction structures are more challenging. You have to have bigger crystals and a source of neutrons. But the key thing about neutron diffraction is that it locates where the hydrogen atoms are. So this is a structure where the hydrogens aren't just placed in the structure by assumption, as they would be in crystal structures mostly. They have been found. Yes, on the website there's a Magic Eye 3D thing. So if you click on one of my octahedra, tetrahedra on the side of the screen, you'll get a note card and you can cut and paste and go to my little website. Okay, so anyway, DNA style encoding is out. Could sheet layers encode information? Well, funny you should say that. I was thinking about this and then found that Linus Pauling in the 1930s predicted silicates could roll up into scrolls. Okay, so continuing my advice for the hard science fiction writer, scrolls were actually discovered in the 1950s in chrysotile, a form of asbestos. And chrysotile can actually be made in the lab, and it can be made as nanotubes, and you can also make nanotubes from copper silicate. So some interesting more 1D type structure. So here's chrysotile. It's magnesium 3Si2O9H4, and there's one floating above. Let's see if I can move it down to the floor level. Edit, come down, move it, and move it out. And so this guy This guy is basically an asbestos, form of asbestos. There's a lot of different minerals are called asbestos, I guess. And what we can see is green octahedra, which contain the alumina, red tetrahedra, which contain the magnesium ions, and the tan silicate tetrahedra. These things form sheets. And I've got a stereo GIF on the site where you can see the extent of these sheets. They form very big sheets. Let me move this out of the way and I've got some pictures. Ooh. Yes, thanks, Patio. I've focused a lot of time this week on getting stuff together for a 3D presentation. Next slide. Okay, so here's X-ray data for synthetic chrysotile. I've got this picture rotating up on the site. And you can do the cross-site thing and see this rotating in 3D. When it rotates into a side-on position, it's really striking how these layers are. This is basically how the layers of the chrysotile line up just in a regular crystal. Okay, so where are we now? So we can talk about silicate nanotubes a little bit. Nearing the end of my talk, I think. These are electron micrographs. On the left, it's natural halocyte, which is a form of this chrysotile. They form tubes. So from where the pointer is now to where it is now, that distance, says mu, that's 1 micron. So that's 1,000 nanometers. So these tubes have widths that are, and they're hollow, that are of nanometer dimensions, like 50 to 100 nanometers, I would say. These are calculations, basically, of what such tubes could look like when they roll up. They could be several different chiralities, basically several different arrangements. Kind of very similar to what graphene does. We have carbon nanotubes, for example, now that are known. These things are multi-layered, which is kind of cool. Oh, I don't know how they would compare to carbon ones. I think they'd be pretty strong. Because silicon oxygen bonds are stronger than carbon oxygen bonds. So here's some more synthetic silicate nanotubes, and you can kind of see there's the copper silicate on the left and the chrysotile nanotubes on the right. So we have evidence of tubes that form like this. And in fact, this idea that they can roll up into scrolls, I kind of like the idea that the genetic code could be written on the scroll. Anyway, the idea that the chrysotile can roll up into scrolls was explored in a paper in, it's a Russian paper, but it was in published in English in Technical Physics Letters, I think in January of 2016. And, the rolling process boils down to a lot of different factors, both mechanical and chemical. But essentially, if you look at the model I've built, there's basically a model, or there's basically a layer of the green octahedra and a layer of the tan tetrahedra. And if they are mismatched, in how they bond to each other, it's going to form some stress on the layers, which causes them to curl up. It does look like a jelly roll. So, continuing my advice for the hard science fiction writer, we had 2 billion years of single-celled life on this planet. The Horda is going to be real hard to figure out how a silicon-based cell is going to interact with other silicon-based cell, because we don't even know how a single cell, what that would look like for a silicon life form. So let's keep it simple. Let's think about what we need to encode the information. So here's my advice. If you use scrolls and you have defects where some sort of redox active metal is substituted for an aluminum 3 plus, okay, so those green octahedra in the chrysotile structure, pull out an aluminum 3 plus, I don't know, put an iron 3 plus in there. The thing about aluminum is that it stays 3 plus. It doesn't want to be 2 plus. It can't be 4 plus. You can't do much with aluminum. If you put in another metal, you have the option of changing oxidation state, and that can change shape. So we would need to move stuff around in some sort of silicon life forms. Well, we got nanotubes. We know we have evidence that nanotubes can form both naturally and synthetically, making particles flow through nanotubes or being dragged along nanotubes is something that's not too alien from our kind of life. And we know zeolites, which are silicate, aluminosilicate minerals, some of which are formed artificially, they are known to catalyze chemical reactions. In fact, the zeolite can be used, is used in hydrocarbon cracking. It takes crude oil and turns it into lighter fractions. You have to use high temperatures to make that happen, which wouldn't be a problem down deep in planet's crust. So hopefully I'm not coming off as crazy and saying, hey, we got silicon-based life forms. All I'm trying to say is that we could, there, you know, it's not out of the question that this chemistry could happen. So for us, we have DNA, which makes RNA, which makes proteins, which makes living things. We would need to encode information. We would need to transfer that encoding somehow. We would need to use that encoding to do things. And I think that the chemistry of silicates can get us there. So can you unroll a scroll so it can be read? And my official answer is dunno. It's for fiction, I'm going to assume it can. So if I were writing the story, I'd use the vanadium 3 plus and vanadium 4 plus. Because if you have strategic replacement of aluminum 3 plus with vanadium 3 plus, both prefer to be octahedral. Injection or removal of an electron to make vanadium 4 plus tends to make vanadium 4 tends to want to be square pyramidal. Here's the thing. What it means is that one corner of the octahedron is released, and that could put enough stress in a layer to allow it to preferentially flatten. A lot of different metals could be used. We've got copper 2 plus, which wants to be octahedral, but copper plus, since that's a d10, it's got 10 electrons in the d orbitals, copper plus would prefer to be tetrahedral. So again, that would encourage a structural change. Okay, now I'm not saying that any of this has ever happened anywhere, but it's within the realm of fiction to be discussed. So, why the transition metals? Electron transfer pathway also helps energy flow, because We're going to have to worry about where this life is going to get its energy from. Probably chemical energy, like hydrothermal vents. There's a severe lack of sunlight underground, so it's not going to be based on photosynthesis like it is on the surface of our planets. Hydrothermal energy is probably going to be the sort of energy that keeps things going. And so electron transfer is a way of taking chemical energy, changing chemicals into other chemicals, and I like to think of life as a Rube Goldberg machine, where you put a little ball that represents an electron in the top, and it bounces around and makes a billion different things happen until it's spit out at the bottom. That would be the pathway for energy flow. And the structural consequences of electron transfer give us a mechanism, give us an excuse to say how shape changes might happen. So you might have rolling or unrolling of scrolls. I'm not sure if copper plus or 2 plus can do the same thing for nanotubes, but hey, this is not a bad place to start. So, I'm getting near to the end of my talk. Sorry I've gone on so long. I was really excited about this stuff. Here's stuff I drew. So, basically you can think of scrolls replicating by peeling apart. This would be a double layer scroll, and then having silicates and aluminates being assembled. From the unread part. If we had a scroll that partially unrolled and gave us a gap in the middle, there could be ways of reading out information there. I was not drunk when I drew this, so I really have no excuse. But these were some scribbles as to how I was thinking when we were putting that together. So, at this point, we need to make some conclusions. We're going to need a low-carbon environment if silicon is going to play an important role. I don't know if that's a deal-breaker. We've got a small amount of carbon in the crust of this planet, I don't know how far the carbon goes down. It probably goes down thousands of miles. If we have carbon around, it's going to supplant silicon as being the primary information storage medium for any living process. Okay, this might be the deal breaker. Okay, I think I actually came into the talk thinking, yeah, well, there's no way the hoarder could happen. That's all BS. Can't happen. But over the past few months of putting this stuff together, it's like, okay, well, yeah, if I'm going to be fair, I can't just say it can't happen. But it would be very unlikely to be able to happen by itself. Now that doesn't mean that we can't make scrolls and nanotubes open and close through redox. If we could do that, that would open up this debate a bit more, I think. So under the right conditions, aluminosilicates certainly have a lot of interesting chemistry, and might even be the type of chemistry that initiates self-catalysis, and self-catalysis would lead to Darwinian evolution. And if we were going to look for this stuff, I would expect to find, we'll call them defect-filled nanoparticles. And these defects would have to recur almost identically from particle to particle if they form by replication. I'm pretty certain we have not found anything like that on our planet. It would be nice, but it's probably not going to happen here. So, where are we now? So, thanks. Here's Bert. Bert is alive and happy somewhere in my house. But I want to thank you for your attention, especially for letting me go on so long about this. thank my students and faculty for their support. I took off early a couple of days this week to put the finishing touches on this. As always, the National Science Foundation supports my work with Dr. Victor Adu on the heme nitrosyl complexes. We were funded again as of this summer, so that's good. And my cats for their patience, because they no one walked on the keyboard this morning. And oops, I think, yeah, that's going to be in the next talk, so ignore that. So we'll go back to the next slide. So you see why I've broke this into two talks, because low temperature life is a whole other ball of wax. All right, well, thank you for all your attention. I'm going to enjoy scrolling through the comments a bit later. I'm happy to answer questions. Thank you, Jess. Bye-bye, CB. I'm very happy making these talks because now I got a bunch of slides I can use in my own classes. Don't know if you noticed the background of each slide is actually granite, which is a bunch of silicates and aluminosilicates. Yes, I am recording this, so with any luck, and I think I've had good luck recording my own, we'll be able to post this one. Could silicon life be on high gravity planets? Possibly. Possibly. I don't see any reason why it couldn't. I don't think it's going to be very complex life. I mean, the stuff I've been talking about is basically silicon-based viruses. I would think that high gravity could possibly do. It would certainly help with the fractionation of elements so that maybe carbon is at the surface and squeezed out from lower down. You think we can finally find an extraterrestrial animal made of silicon? Man, probably not. Probably not. I mean, we're gonna have to find the right place to go. And that's maybe not in our solar system. Thank you. So there are biocomputers as a concept. Could silicon bring that concept closer to reality? Yeah, I mean, all deals are off if, or I'm sorry, all bets are off on if we create silicon-based life. I think that you have to be a little careful about what you would choose as the hardware in your biocomputer. If you're choosing our kind of life, we have a lot of knowledge about how to manipulate that kind of life, and that's going to be a lower barrier to getting that life. Or getting those computers constructed. For if we were going to set out as a research project to create silicon-based life, then that is a huge barrier in itself to then using it as a computer. So you probably wouldn't call it an animal. That's true. That's true. I would leave it to the discoverers to name it. Yes, DNA-based computers. High-pressure chemistry, radically different to our chemistry. Yes. I mean, the example that comes to mind is what hydrogen does under high pressures. Hydrogen is a gas in our experience and liquefies at, I forget its boiling points, like under 20 Kelvin. But if you pressurize hydrogen in diamond anvils, or think about what hydrogen is going to do at the core of Jupiter, it's thought to be a liquid metal under those conditions. So, high pressure can radically change the structures of materials that we find commonly in our own experience are very different from what they might be a few miles underground. I love the science and science fiction. Yes. We like we really like the hard science fiction and do like to try and keep it as real as possible when we're looking at or when we're reading books. Alistair Reynolds, for example, is one of our favorite authors. Do they make better orthotics by improved silicon after breast cancer? Let's see. That's not one I can answer very well. I do know a little about silicone as a as a type of plastic, but no, I can't give you a good answer on that one, Ariane. Cats aren't patient till they want something. Yeah, mine just left. Excellent. Well, I think what I will do is call it quits there and then wander off. I have to mow the lawn and do the rest of the day. I'm very happy that you all came today and enjoyed, and I will work with Jess and Shan to set up another silicon-based life talk under cryogenic conditions this time for the spring. All right. All right, take care. All right, recording has been stopped. Yay, you can say what you really think now. Yay. All right. Shovel the lawn. No, actually, it's 84 here today. I'm sorry, 84 Fahrenheit today. So that's kind of, I think, what, 28, 29 Celsius. It's very strange. All right. So I'll leave these things set up for part of this week and move them over to my little area and see if I can. See if I can get the recording to Chan in a timely fashion. So, all right. Well, if you're from a place that celebrates Halloween, have a happy and not too scary Halloween. If you want to be scared, you can turn on American news and look at the election results or the election coverage. Yay! Alrighty. Well, I'm gonna head out, so everyone have an excellent day. Okay.